April 1st, and so starting in late 2008, improving it in 2009, and then in 2010, we got the first approved. I think it was another game changer for IRI, and not only in money terms, but also in terms of how we operate. So if you just look at our revenue trends, so 2005-06, I said we were at 30 million. Many things were already being done in the subsequent years that put us on the right track, but Chris provided a quantum leap. Let's face it. So without that, we wouldn't be where we are now. So we can call that the Grisp effect. Now that includes revenue that goes to Africa Horizon here as well. It's not just IRI money. But still, it was a substantial change. We also see similar trends that in our staff numbers, which is of course the bread and butter. If you want to increase the outputs of the institution, the outcomes, the impacts, everything just went up since 2005-06. Not only at headquarters, but increasingly also in our outposted locations in the different countries. And of course, what you probably enjoy most is we build things. We all like to build things. We're all builders. We like to construct new buildings, renovate new labs, new greenhouses, whole new divisions were built, a whole new beautiful regional hub in Burundi as one of the last ones. New gadgets to play with for farm people, new scientific equipment like this Eddie Kuvarian's flux tower, Maricar, Alberto took these things on the run, and this is her last year, I think, presenting her PhD thesis that resulted from this work. And we had also creative minds inside IRI who came up with innovation solutions like this one, using the warm air from the air conditioned systems of the GM facility to use as mobile drying of biomass samples in those containers. Energy saving technology. Beautiful work. And I would say that many, many times, none of these things would have been possible if we had not taken very strict measures for cost recovery. You all hate it, everybody thinks we're too expensive, we're charging too much, everything. This is the effect. No, we went from zero before to more than $10 million of cost recovery within the restricted grants. That's money that otherwise would have been taken from window one or window two GRISP. We wouldn't have been able to build many of these things and have much GOC that for research. So, please keep doing this and keep supporting management with that. This is a slide I showed also in my seminar in February 2008. That's how I imagined a proper career path and a promotion and broadbanding system for NRS could look like that plan. And I'm very pleased that what we have now just created in recent weeks is pretty much like that. So I can't really take credit for this because that's obviously led by Fiona and her team and many others. But it does, at that point, a very sticky issue. And I think we have come a long way now to create a much, much better system. There has been an increase in scientific publications, as you can see. But it's not correlated enough with the increase in investment. So we've gone up by about 50% publications, but funding has tripled. So I think it's an area that we need to, need to keep an eye on in terms of making sure that the high quality of science standards are kept high and that they also translate into high quality publications. I just want to point this out. Within the CT system, we're still usually on top of those lists in terms of scientific citation impact and those kind of things. But that's where IRI needs to be. IRI needs to be different, it needs to be on top. It can't be average. And I think we've had some very impressive impact examples, which you all are very much aware of. And this one, sub-1 dissemination in India, has been an eye-opener in the sense that it involved message is that if we have great products, like in this case the Sapphire variety, we must also pay attention to bringing those products out to the user. And in that process also you can get also feedback on what else is needed and what goes and what doesn't work and get better. More recently, I think the thinking in terms of product-oriented R&D has taken on a new dimension. And the breeders are leading the way by really structuring their programs and their whole divisional operational processes in product-oriented variety development pipelines that are supposed to meet very clearly defined market demands, and therefore allow also specifying trade packages more clearly and breeding strategies and approaches along with it, and cross-cutting R&D and service functions that provide the necessary discovery as well as service support across the different breeding programs in a faster, more efficient manner. And I think that's a general message that I would like to leave, that we should learn from that in two ways. One is, everything can be done faster. No reason for why it takes 7 or 8 years to develop a variety. Let's do it in 3 or 4. Why not? And you can do the similar principle in some other areas. And the other point I would say is that other disciplines which haven't gone through that kind of thinking yet should look at it as an example and say, well, okay, we're not breeders. Maybe we're agronomists or social scientists or whatever. But why can't we align our approach to research somewhat similar manner to this kind of thinking that we have a more interdisciplinary and stronger approach. So that's something that remains to be done, and I think there's a lot of potential. So if I would summarize my experience as DDGR, I think it's largely to find the right balance between being good, bad, or sometimes you have to be happy. That is also because you're sometimes faced with pretty ugly things. And there are things that where I would say now, well, seemed like a good idea at that time, it just didn't work. And here is one of them. So when we designed the GRISP and our own internal program management strategies, we thought that underneath of that we would have product teams with a product team leader who would be some kind of a champion rallying the troops and making sure that people work together for this product. With a few exceptions, I would say that has been a grandiose failure so far. So there are lessons to learn from that, and I think we did not empower those people enough. There was no resources coming along with that. No, you know, it was basically a goodwill champion type of approach. And I thought, well, you know, could work, it just didn't. Sounded like a good idea. Now, this one was another idea, therefore, as an alternative, which I presented before that structure came in place. I presented it in November 2008 to the IPC, and it was completely rejected by pretty much everybody as something that sounded just crazy. But I want you to take another look at it now. That's why I'm showing it. Yeah, so because I said at that time, well, you know, why don't we have just 4 big programs or whatever you call them, which are run more like business units, you know? Let's call them business units. And so each of them might have a business center and a, you know, a director or a leader or whatever kind, you know. And in that you have these product teams. But much more business-oriented teams, including the resources coming with that. Then restricted projects just feed the whole pool. Because we also need to get beyond that project silo thinking. We need to think about programs and products. But it would require a fundamentally different approach to also manage the money for restricted projects, and even for what at that time was still called unrestricted funding, could also be directed in a different way. So I looked at that yesterday thinking, okay, maybe you can pull it out again and come up with something better. That time it just was one step way too far. Good point. And this slide I showed first at a meeting of the joint Eastern Southern Africa program in Tanzania in December 2008. December 2010, where I was trying to explain to the Erie Staff President and the Africa Rice Staff President, together with my counterpart Marco Boporice, that we should move from this kind of working operation towards something like that. So I think at that time a lot of our work was almost like this, you know, pulling in opposite directions. So I was trying to make a case that, okay, can we at least have start out by more communication, sharing certain resources and information. It could still probably go off in our own ways, and then hopefully later on come up with a more coherent, joint approach in which people from different organizations actually work together on a common good or common project. Now that utterly failed as well. And we had similar experiences in CISA, if I may mention another one. And it's mainly because of cultural differences among organizations and people, which are not easy to overcome just by goodwill. And they have to be managed in a different way, and I don't think we have been completely successful in this yet, also particularly when it comes to our relationship with Africa Rice, which I think has still a lot more potential than what we are currently capturing. So I've drawn a few personal lessons from that. So the first one is that it's all about people. Anything else in science or any organization doesn't matter. If you don't have the right people, if they're not happy, if they can't do what they could be doing, forget the rest. So for me, as a novice research manager and leader, that has been the most interesting experience, having to deal with many of them. The next lesson, I think, is yes, you can think big, as Paul says, and I like to do this, but you also need to set realistic goals and go in the right order about them. And even more so, you have to be proactive, not about doing. And I like really this Chinese proverb that says the journey of a thousand miles must begin with a single step. If you just keep talking, and you don't make that first step, nothing's going to happen. And that's something that I think we are often not very good at. This is my gender statement. I don't need to comment more. It's an absolute truth. If anybody, I just recommend you just hire more. Just do it. Your life is going to be so much easier. I also learned that not every problem has a clear solution. I thought, as a men usually like to fix things. Okay? They like to be presented with a problem. Broken car or something, they like to fix it. But in research management, not every sort of broken problem has indeed a clear solution. Sometimes it is actually more important to have harmony rather than trying to aim for total mastery or even total victory. That's one of the good bar wisdom, so famous Chinese generals, whatever his name was. So, but very much what I experienced. And another lesson is that you must have absurd ideas. It's perfectly fine. Einstein put it really on the spot by saying that if the idea is not absurd, then there is absolutely no hope for it. So think outside the box, come up with crazy things, it's perfectly fine. And if it turns out to be wrong, it's okay. And despite all the stuff I had to deal with, sometimes just create some fun for yourself. This is something you can do. And I had a tremendous amount of fun just doing that as a personal learning lesson, but also getting away from some of the normal daily routines and other things we deal with at a much bigger level. Go back down to the fields and try things yourself. Try to put in practice what we preach to people, and you will really enjoy it. It's going to be great fun in your job. So, a few slides on the future. Where to next? So, for Erie, I think the future is clear. We had a very good visioning exercise The Director General
understands that, of course.
And I would like to suggest that since it is the Winter Olympics, maybe if we take a page from the competitive sports world and say that we want to be faster, higher, stronger. And this could be my suggestion for a new Hero logo, if you can sort out that. It's all about the IP rights with the International Olympic Committee. So, Bob, I think, is providing excellent leadership, and he always wants to be faster than anybody else. So, just try to follow him, and if possible, overtake him. He needs your support. Matthew needs it also, in particular. The future is bright, and many things can be done that haven't been done yet. So thank you, Harry.
Thank you. questions?
I'd like to know how you ever passed up a musical career.
The background to this is that I have absolutely no capacity to memorize the lyrics. What you didn't see is that people in the front row were holding up the lyrics. That's why I cannot have a musical career.
Anything else, or shock, or awe?
Just plain wonderment, please.
For young people at Erie that are only here for a few years, I was wondering what kind of advice you'd like to give us for making the most out of our time here, but also perhaps leaving some small impact in the short time.
Yeah, I was in a similar situation because when I came in '92, I only had a 3-year contract. German-funded, basically a postdoc kind of thing. So I wasn't planning to be at Erie that long. But I saw it as a very interesting opportunity to, and in two ways. One was I had some own ideas, which nobody else in Erie was pursuing at that time. So I said, okay, you know, I bring in some skills that don't exist, so maybe I can make a little bit of difference in that area. But then the other thing that I wanted to get out of that is really also to learn as much as possible from other scientists and research groups that were working already here and had a long history, and so I was wanting to really absorb as much of that knowledge. And then I was hoping to somehow make use of that in my own work. So I think that's basically what happened. So initially I was very focused on my own little research project, but then after about a year and a half or so, I started getting engaged in many other activities which were not actually part of my project work in a way. You know, it was part of the, you could say, part of the dogfight going on between two division heads. Because one wanted me to work on this and the other one on that, and I decided to work on both. So I got myself dragged into other things out of interest.